Well, this morning we continue our study through our Lord Jesus Christ's Sermon on the Mount. People from all walks of life gathered to hear a teaching that amazed them. Most of this crowd is not of the religious or social elite, but the outcasts, the poor, the destitute. They know the earthly oppression of the Romans as well as the holy weight of their Old Testament law. In every sense, they are starving for a Savior. And now, their Savior is speaking. He begins with the Beatitudes. It's stunning. Blessedness doesn't come from being a king in this world. It comes from knowing the king of this world and being given by him a new nature. Wow. That's how he starts his sermon. And then with last week's message on verses 10 through 12, we see Christ is turning our attention to consider what will be the outward expression and results of those blessings, these new internal realities. John showed us last week that Christian righteousness will get a response. And in verses 10 through 12, it will result at times in insults and persecution. This week in verses 13 through 16, a different potential response: God's glorification. If you are a true Christian, the markers of your internal life in Christ, your Christian character, will be exposed to fellow believers and the watching world, all for the glory of God as we grow and bear more and more fruit for Him. This passage, I trust, will strengthen and motivate you to minister to others on God's behalf. You see, it's not a degree or accomplishment or some outward status or ability that qualifies you for ministry, but rather your relationship with the Father, your union in Christ, and your empowerment by the Spirit. That's what qualifies you for ministry. Believer, you are a minister. And this passage will challenge you. It'll challenge you to ask, what should others experience when they're around you? What should others experience when they're around you? Or what should others see when they look at you? What should result from these interactions that they have with you? If you're not already there in your Bibles, will you turn with me to Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 16 as we look there at our text this morning. Our Lord says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Let's pray. Oh, Father in heaven, we do come before you this morning asking that you would do something wonderful here. Would you open our eyes, Lord, to see glorious and wondrous truths from your word, that we would have it applied to our lives, that we would go out from this place having been built up by your word so that we can serve and minister and love others well. And that in doing so, oh Lord, allow us to bring you glory. May it be that wherever you have appointed us, wherever you have placed us, that we would shine for you, Lord. Not so that we would get the glory, Lord Jesus, not to us, but to your name alone be all the glory. forever and ever. Amen. Jesus is the master of metaphor. The master of metaphor. He's comparing two different objects here in this text using one or more shared characteristics in order to underscore or explain truth. Master of metaphor. Salt and light are two angles, if you will, from which we can better understand how to live out our Christian calling. In verse 13, I trust you'll see we must have an enduring usefulness. And then in verses 14 through 16, that we must have an illuminating witness. The imagery of salt and light is so helpful. It's designed, though, to drive you to verse 16, that as new creations in Christ, we would do good works so the world gives God glory. That's the central purpose of this text. You could even go so far as to say it's the central purpose of Christ's Sermon on the Mount, to say that we would do good works in His name so the world would give God glory. More would come to Him, to know Him, to love Him, to serve Him as Lord and Master. Let's begin with the first point you'll see in the outline, enduring usefulness. Verse 13, the beginning of it says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored?" Two questions likely jump off the page. Why are you called salt as a believer? And can salt even lose its taste? What does it mean? Let's begin with the second one and then come back to the first. The phrase for salt having lost its taste is very interesting. It's an effort to translate the Greek word morino, from which we get our word moronic. It means to become foolish or useless. So if salt has become foolish or useless or tasteless, how shall it be restored? Can you salt salt? To lose its taste indicates that it has lost its usefulness. If it doesn't taste like salt, it's not going to work like salt. Now, the processed, chemically pure salt that you probably have sitting on your kitchen counter is a little different, maybe. It's a mineral comprised of sodium and chloride, known for its stability. That's a little different, though, than maybe at the time what Christ may have been referring to. In its pure form, it doesn't lose its salty sodium chloride taste. But there are different kinds of salts or chloride compounds, and around the Dead Sea, it's common to find a mixture that would look like, taste like, and act like salt, unless it's exposed to the elements. Then the sodium chloride might leach out. So it loses the taste of salt, and the substance left behind might look like salt. It leaves something behind, but it does not act like it and would not taste like it. So let's return to the first question for the believer. Why does Jesus call you salt? First of all, it's not the modern expression like he's the salt of the earth. That's, you know, you kind of, that person, they're the salt of the earth. He's not calling hardworking, humble people salt. He's calling citizens of the heavenly kingdom salt. There's a big difference. And we're going to look at that. Now, salt has many qualities that make it a very valuable commodity then and now. Especially in the ancient world, its usefulness is a therapeutic, a cleanser, a preservative. It was an essential element of one's diet, a flavor enhancer. It makes steak even more perfect. But why does Christ declare that you, his people, are salt? There's some explanations that are often suggested. One would be that it maybe represents a moral purity that Christians must have among the world. Or maybe our lives are to cause the world to have a thirst for God. Maybe it stings a little bit when you're cleansing a wound, and you may need to sting a little bit at times. Another suggestion, maybe Christians are used by God as agents of preservation, stemming the tide of lawlessness or moral decay of the world until Christ returns. Now, these analogies certainly hold validity, but it appears the meaning that best fits this text has an agricultural angle that would have instantly resonated with Christ's original audience. You see, salt is a highly effective cultivating agent as well. It's often used in the ancient world especially, but even today, to aid in fertilization. It's able to both kill weeds and, maybe most surprisingly, increase crop yield or even rejuvenate once barren land. It needs to be used properly, but has amazing qualities as a cultivating agent. Let's read together Luke 14, 34 through 35. A parallel verse of the same one we're looking at today gives a bit more of the agrarian or agricultural perspective we're talking about. Luke records Christ saying, "Salt is good." Amen. "But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown away." Now, wait a second. Christ assumes you know that it ordinarily would have some use for the soil and as a fertilizer. But if the saltiness leaches out, it leaves behind a substance that looks like salt but has no functional value. The once multi-purpose salt is now a sort of fool's salt. It's not really salt. It might look the part. It's no longer useful. It's only good for being grit under your feet to keep you from slipping outside on the steps this morning, as Matthew's text reads. Again, Matthew 5:13, the second part of it. It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. Now, how should a true believer respond to that last phrase? What does it mean to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet in this case? If the loss of savor and saltiness refers primarily to usefulness, the response of the believer should be self-examination, but not self-condemnation. You catch the difference there, I hope? Self-examination, not self-condemnation. Christ teaches the total security of the true believer. Let's read together John 10, 27 through 28, one comforting evidence from Christ among many in his word. He says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them." That's stunning. "I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand." Total security. Our text this morning is not a call for the believer to doubt their salvation, but instead to do good works in keeping with the miracle of your salvation. It's not for condemnation, but it may be for self-reflection and self-examination. And we could ask ourselves, what's kind of a major implication of this first point? I think a major application and implication of this first point is that the Beatitudes are the basis for cultivating others around you. Think about that for a second. The context of Christ's statements here in this section of our text this morning, the context is the Beatitudes. They are the basis for cultivating others around you. You were not saved to sit around ineffective, isolated, fearfully distant from others, just waiting for Jesus to return. No, you've been saved for a purpose, to do good works so God gets glory. And you must have an enduring usefulness, a desire to be used of God, or the ABC of Christianity. Always be cultivating. That's my little joke there. Always be cultivating. What does this cultivation look like, though? What does it look like? It's the Beatitudes in you, at work in those around you, as you support those in the faith. There's an aspect of it where it's believers we're supporting and cultivating. How useful, we should ask ourselves, how useful am I being right now at cultivating other believers for God's glory? There's an aspect of this that relates to your brother and sister in Christ. How are you doing cultivating other believers for God's glory? What are you doing on a regular basis to help your brothers and sisters grow and flourish? I would say this is a primary reason behind the prioritization of our church of the care group ministry. I absolutely love our care group. It is a joy to be a part of our care group. And it is incredible to see, if you look back over the weeks and months and years together, the incredible growth that comes because of what God is doing in the small group context of our care groups. It is amazing. You're walking shoulder to shoulder with other Christians to stimulate one another to love and good deeds. It is a joy, and you are cross-pollinating each other with God's word so that we would bear more and more fruit. What are you doing now? What will you do this week to cultivate fruit in fellow believers to God's glory? What else does this cultivation look like? There's an aspect of it that looks like cultivating the world. And what do we mean by that? It's the Beatitudes in you working to prepare new soil for the gospel seed to be planted, watered, and nourished. How useful am I being right now for the furthering of God's kingdom and the spreading of his gospel around me? That's a question we have to ask ourselves. And I will say real quickly, as an aside, parents, I firmly believe that the work of parenting is an incredible opportunity for you to cultivate non-believers for God's glory. That's the goal, to establish a foundation for them of what God's gospel truth looks like, so that when the gospel seed is planted, they're ready. Their hearts are ready. Those little ones' hearts are ready. That's a wonderful goal of parenting. Is that we would be preparing our heart, the hearts of our kids, to receive the glories of the gospel. But no matter what your circumstances or where you're located or what your calling is in this life, what you're doing, it ought to be your new natural bent as a Christian to be an ambassador for Christ so that more would come to know him and love him. It's your direct engagement with the lost, that they would see close up what it looks like to have Christ-like character that produces good works, and that this would even help them be ready to receive the gospel. It's a wonderful work that Christ calls you to, calls me to. Now, don't forget the gospel comes with words. Romans 10 is very clear about that. We need to speak the gospel truths. But our passage this morning is reminding us of something that is amazing, that the what we do and the how we do it can, by God's grace, help the unbeliever's heart be ready to receive his word. I pray that by the same grace working in and through you, and through me, that we would do good works so the world around us gives God glory. We saw how Christ used this first metaphor to challenge our hearts. It's a metaphor of salt. Now in verses 14 through 16, he uses the metaphor of light. First we saw we must have an enduring usefulness. Now we'll see we must have an illuminating witness. Let's read together verses 14 through 15. Christ says, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house." Now, the first question you might need to ask here is important, but it might seem obvious. Why does the world need light to begin with? You're probably thinking, Zach, this is obvious. Have you read the news lately? The moral decay of our world is obvious. Sin abounds. Wars and conflicts are everywhere. Do you read anything? But we have to ask the question properly so we can answer it biblically. The world does not need light simply to gain more morality, just to be better people. 10 steps to a better you is not what the world needs. The goal should not be to achieve world peace, apart from Christ. Let's read together 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4. Why does the world need light? "In their case, the god of this world, Satan, has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God." Now, the light the world needs is not merely a reversal of bad things so they would be good people. They need a full and shining awareness of the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ. They need to be made right with God. There is no light apart from that. The first thing the world needs to be made right with God, not simply to have their morality fixed. Christ came, the image of the invisible God, and he came, the light of the world, to save sinners from the domain of darkness. John 8:12, Christ says, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." The world needs Christ. Now, if he is the light of the world, we should be asking ourselves, how can his followers be called the light? You should be asking that. So which is it? Is Christ the light of the world, or are we the light of the world? Yes. David answered yes. Let's look at that. Are we just little, like supposed to become little gods, as the cults would teach us? Is that what it means to be the light when he's the light? I don't think so. Paul is very helpful here. Let's look together at a couple different passages that will help us unpack this a little bit further. The Apostle Paul says in Philippians 2:14-15, "Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish." Where? In the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. How is this possible, Paul? It helps us in another letter. Paul writes in Ephesians 5:8-9, he says, "For at one time you were darkness." Note, not just you walked darkly. You were darkness. But now you are light in the world. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. You want more help on this? Go to 1 John. He will talk all about what it means to walk in the light as he is in the light. Notice, though, there's a change of nature here, not just outward actions, right? You were darkness. Now you are light. There's a change of nature. And it's interesting that in our text for this morning, Christ doesn't just say, "Reflect the light." He could have said that. He could have said something like that. He doesn't quite say that. Though there's an aspect of that, I'm sure, in that we would reflect Christ, and we often will say that, right? There's nothing wrong with saying you're reflecting the light of Christ. And there is something very distinct here. He uses an indicative mood to indicate that you are the light. There's a idea he's trying to communicate there about your nature, who you are. Can you imagine, just for a second, if Christ hadn't said this particular phrase, can you imagine anyone having the audacity to claim that? Think about it for a second. Imagine Christ hadn't said this, and then just some guy gets up here and says, "You know what? You are the light of the world." You would think, "You're crazy. Jesus said in John 8:12 that he's the light of the world. You're nuts." It's astounding what he says here. And so what does it mean? It's only possible because of a changed nature. It's only possible because Galatians 2:20 is true. And other similar verses. Let's read that together. Paul says, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." You see, ours is a derived light. It's not from within ourselves. We're not just enlightened people. We get it from outside ourselves and then put it inside ourselves. It's a derived light. He's the source. It's a provided righteousness. Sometimes we say an alien righteousness because it comes from outside of us, and Christ imputed it, put it on you, and said, "You are righteous." That's astounding and amazing. Instead of walking according to the course of this world, you now get to share in Christ's life and work. You get to proclaim freedom to captives among whom you once lived and now can call to Christ. The true believer is called to a holiness that is only possible by your union with Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. It is not possible on your own. You can't make this happen all on your own. You need the work of Christ. Your union with Christ makes it possible. Where the world is evil, wrong, and false, you must be marked by what is good, true, and right. How does Christ explain this metaphor further? If we look back at our text this morning, verses 14 through 15, it's interesting he uses images for us again of a city and a lamp. It's helpful, and I could see maybe there appears to be a couple different reasons at least that he would use these images to help us. The first reason might simply be that light is an indicator of life. Light's an indicator of life. If you were stranded on the side of the road in these frigid temperatures outside, wind whipping at your face, and your eyes can hardly even see anything, it's getting dark, and you're afraid that you may not last the night. If you spot something off in the distance, though, a little glimmer of light, boy, as best you can in this weather, you're going to be running toward that light. Because the hope is that there's life there. Imagine there was a house on the side of the road and it had its light on. You think, there's someone there. Maybe they could help me. A second reason I think is really helpful, that these images are really helpful, is to kind of make you recoil at the non sequitur. What do I mean by that? It's kind of make you jump back and think, that's impossible. What do I mean? No one in their right mind exerts all their efforts to build a city on a hill and then wonder, why is it so easy for people to find? That's bizarre. No one in their right mind lights an oil lamp, which at the time requires maintenance. You need to trim the wick, refill the oil, you need to take care of it, keep it lit, and then that person covers it with a basket and wonders, why is it so dark in here? Bizarre. It would be absolutely bizarre for the God-gifted inner life and character of a Christian to have no effect on the Christian's conduct. That would be weird. You'd never expect that. Let me say that again. It would be bizarre if the God-gifted inner life and character of a Christian had no effect on their conduct. That would be weird. You are lights for the world. You've been designed to shine the way to life in Christ. And I understand you may say, Zach, I struggle with doubt, though. I don't want to mess up. I don't want to say something wrong or forget a Bible verse, especially when I'm talking to unbelievers. I can definitely relate. That's why I love the rest of that passage we started to look at before, 2 Corinthians 4, 6 through 7. And I'm going to add verse 15 at the end. It's amazing. We even sang of this earlier. For God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give the light. Do you see that? Give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. Verse 15. So that As grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. That's awesome. He has saved you, not because of anything you've done to earn it. And you, imperfect as you are, you're just a jar of clay. You're earthenware. It'd be weird if we went digging in the Middle East somewhere and found this earthenware jar filled with amazing treasure and gold and jewels. And we were like, look at this jar. Isn't the jar awesome? No, you would never think that. You would look at the treasure. That's the life of a Christian. That when they look at you, they don't look at you and say, that's a really nice jar. Boy, I've never seen a better clay pot. Amazing. No, it's that they would look at you and say, wow, I see Christ coming through you. The way you speak to me, the way you act around me, the way you help me, pray for me, challenge me, I see the words of Christ in your actions. That gives them an opportunity to glorify God because they're not looking at the clay pot that forgot the Bible reference again. They're looking, we trust and we pray. They're looking and seeing Christ at work in our hearts and in our life, who can also be at work in their hearts and life. He's the treasure. We just keep saying, don't look at me. Look at the treasure. There may be some in this room who don't know the treasure of Christ. And for the unbeliever, for those who do not yet know Christ as their treasure, the call is simple. Come to Christ. Come to Christ. If you believe in him, today you can be instantly and forever transferred from the kingdom of darkness to the glorious kingdom of Christ. Don't wait. What are you waiting for? This treasure of priceless worth is just laying there before you. And the king will gladly welcome you in and give you a new heart with new desires and cause all these wonderful realities of the Beatitudes to be true for you so that you can then go out and multiply his kingdom even more. Trust Christ and know him as your treasure. He'll have transforming power on your life for his glory. We have to ask, before we move on, we have to ask, though, how does this calling that we have, how does it work alongside Matthew 6, verse 1? Look at that text with me. Matthew 6, verse 1. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people, in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Wait a second. I thought I was supposed to shine like a light. I hope you can tell pretty quickly there's a big difference in the words in order to. What's the in order to for your life? You see, the full orb teaching of Scripture includes both private, totally unknown works that you are just kind of doing on the side. You don't want anyone to even know it was you. Christ himself, later in the sermon, will unpack that. That your giving wouldn't be done in secret. That your prayers wouldn't be, that your giving would be done in secret at times. That your prayers would be done in secret at times. Why? Every time he links it back to what's the goal of the Pharisees. He's juxtaposing it with the Pharisees. He's saying, you have to have the goal of glorifying your Father. They have the goal of glorifying themselves. That's a big difference. The Pharisee aims to glorify himself, where the true believer knows that saving grace enables good works that glorify God. So how do we keep the right aim? I commend to you memorizing Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. Let's read this together. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, his masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. God made you alive together with Christ so that you could do good works. If he raised you, he saved you, he designed you, and he prepared works for you, then who gets all the glory? God gets all the glory. He did all the work. That's why we can go now to Matthew 5:16, the culmination of all that we've been looking at, and see what Christ says here. He says, in the same way as those metaphors and imagery I've been teaching you with, in the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. In the Greek, this is an imperative. It is a command, a strong, emphasized command that those who would call themselves Christ's disciples, it's almost like he's saying, you must shine your light. Doing good works so the world gives God glory is not an option. It is an expectation. Your Lord expects you to shine for him. But he's equipped you for that work. Believers must shine because believers are lights. Your internal life, united with Christ, drives your conduct. So that no matter what, in life, in death, in trial, in plenty, in want, in prosperity, in poverty, in martyrdom, in chains, in any circumstance, you give God the glory. Because of what he's done in your life. If you are in Christ, you can be assured nothing can hinder the shining forth of Christ as you depend on him for the strength to live a holy and righteous life full of good works. Nothing can hinder you from shining forth as you depend on him. We should look at, though, something important about Christ's life. You see, Christ did many good works. But isn't it amazing that the one who could draw all the attention to himself still had someone else in mind? And who is that? His Father in heaven. He would often say, in all the works he was doing, I'm doing these works to bear witness of my Father. I'm doing these good works so that my Father in heaven would get the glory, so that his will would be done on earth. He glorified his Father in heaven, bearing witness to him through his works and his words. His Father gets the glory, the fame, the credit, the praise from his life. He's constantly redirecting people to his Father in heaven. And now, as his followers, you can walk in his example. You can walk like Christ walked, never taking credit for yourself or receiving glory for yourself, but always redirecting the praise and the glory to God. That's wonderful. He's enabled that to happen. And he does this with a number of kinds of good works. We should be mindful of what kind of good works we could be talking about here. The kind, one of them, would be those that only Christians can do. Right? That would have to be included here. There's some that only Christians can do. Only you can pray to the Father in the sense that he would be pleased to hear your prayers because you're his child. Or later, that you can pray for your enemies and love your enemies. Later in the sermon, he will unpack what it means to look like a Christian in many different ways. The works that you'll be doing, bearing up under persecution and martyrdom, is an incredible work that you can do. Proclamation of the gospel, turning the other cheek. There's all kinds of things that are distinctly Christian works. And yet, there's also ordinary good works, you might call them, that even unbelievers can do. But there's something very different going on here. They're not pleasing to God. A lifetime full of good works by the unbeliever will not please God. Paul makes it clear. Isaiah makes it clear. Your best works as an unbeliever are as filthy rags before God. They have no value. But the believer pleases his Father in heaven with even what we might look at as ordinary good works. Near the close of Matthew's gospel, Christ tells his disciples that it will be like what it will be like at the end of the ages. Would you just observe with me for a moment? I just think it's amazing what Christ does through Matthew to explain what the end will be like. And boy, it looks a lot like the beginning, if you want to call the Beatitudes the beginning and the end of the age the end. You know, as we see God's kingdom go forth and eventually culminate in his return. Look what he says it'll be like. Matthew 25, 34 through 40. We'll read some of this together. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom." Well, that sounds a lot like the Beatitudes, doesn't it? Come, those who are blessed, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And here comes some very ordinary good works, if you're allowing me to use that term. "For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me." This is the king talking. "I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me." And then there's some confusion. Then the righteous, that's an interesting word. We've seen that in the Beatitudes and in our text. The workers of good, it's who you are driving what you do. Keep that in mind. Who you are is driving what you do. But then the righteous will answer him, saying, "Lord, when did we see you hungry?" They're going to ask all those questions right back to Christ. "When did we see you like this? When did we see you like this?" At the end there in verse 40, Christ, the king, will answer them. "Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me." Those are ordinary good works that they're not just charitable good things to do. In the eyes of your Father, they are amazing and wonderful works that you're doing for him in this world that bring him glory. The early church knew this. Even though they were slandered as being evildoers, they became known for Christ-like compassion. They fed the hungry. They tended the sick. And sadly, there's a reality that Roman families would, at the time, abandon infants that they didn't want outside the city walls, usually. Christians would rescue them, care for them, and raise them. That's what the church became known for. So what does this look like today? What will we be known for? What legacy will we leave? First, there's a bit of our witness to the world that we need to look at. I think some implications from this text. One of them, a major implication from this text, would be that the Christian must make gospel noise. What do I mean by that? This comes from a wonderful a missionary of ours. John was just relaying the story again recently, and it came to my mind. It was a wonderful way to explain a strategy they had when they were abroad. They thought, we need to make gospel noise. People need to know we're around. And so they would do things, sometimes good works, sometimes events, things to show we're here and we're ready to engage with you. A really good example of this in our church life, extended life, is the Czech English camp, the Czech Republic English camp that we helped Marcus and Amy Denny with in the summers. We've got a team that's being sent out there. That's wonderful gospel noise that we're making as a church. Non-believers come to that English camp. We help them, we train them, and then there's also lots of opportunities to rub shoulders with them and help them see the hope that is within us. That's a great example of that. There's examples of that in our church life here. When we hand out invitations to our church activities like our Christmas service and our Easter service, those are wonderful gospel moments. There's been all kinds of different examples of that in our church life and in your individual lives, where you can do things like neighborhood get-togethers. You can do things like freely offering your services for various things that your neighbors or friends may need. Clearing sidewalks, raking leaves, giving someone a ride, buying someone lunch. There's all kinds of different things you can do that would allow you an entry point to engage with the world. You see, Pastor John is not a professional elite minister that only he can minister. No, Ephesians 4 is that we would be equipped by our leaders in our church and our elders and our care group leaders, equipped by one another even to some degree, right? That we would be ministers of the gospel, that all of us would be ministers for Christ. The question might be, are you being equipped? Are you availing yourselves of these opportunities so that you're ready and looking for opportunities to engage with people? Are you finding unique ways where you can be proactive with the gospel, not just reactive? Related to this, the second major implication. This text would call us to reject self-centered living and embrace selfless service. Very similar to what we just covered, but a slight nuance. If Christ came to serve rather than be served, what in your life reflects this same attitude and action? What opportunities are available to you right around you where you can reflect the same attitude and actions of Christ? Are you marked by service to others? How do you see your unique sphere of influence to further God's kingdom by doing good to those whose lives your life touches? You know, I'm not appointed in your sphere of influence. I'm not around the same people you're around. You're not around the same people I'm around. I don't work where you work. I don't go to the grocery store maybe where you go to the grocery store. There's all kinds of examples of you have a divine appointment where you are to spread the gospel and to be a light to those around you. That's going to be in really happy and nice stations of life, and it may even be in some really hard stations of life. If you go through something really hard where you're needing medical treatment, don't miss God's appointment for you in that either. Don't miss, even in the hard times, the trials you're going through, God has appointed me and given me an opportunity here to be a blessing, to be a light to the nurse who's helping me out today. Or to the friend who came over to encourage me, I want to be an encouragement to them too. It's not always going to be easy. But we should be asking ourselves, Lord, how would you use me where I am? Sometimes we can often think about the other people and think, like, well, I wish that God, you just use that person the way that they should really be shining your light better. No. The goal here is to look at yourself and think to yourself, how can I be used of God? I want to be used effectively in God's kingdom and for his glory. So I encourage you to ask yourselves the hard questions. Are you a bright, bold sign pointing the way to Christ? Are you looking for proactive opportunities to do that? Or are you, maybe you don't have a basket to put your light over, but maybe you've taken the dimmer switch and you've turned it way down. Maybe what you're doing is distracting people from who God is. Maybe the way you're acting, maybe the way I'm acting, maybe it's confusing people, distracting them, not helping them see God's work and his word. I want to be aware of that. I trust you want to be aware of that. I don't want my life on the dimmer switch all the way down. I want it full bore. Every time someone sees me, I want them to see more of Jesus. That's my goal. That's my hope. That's my prayer for you and for me, that we would be lights for Christ, bright lights, not mood lighting, bright lights. So we have to ask ourselves, am I being as effective as I possibly can where God has placed me? Are you being as effective as you can for Christ where he has appointed you? We need to say, Lord, wherever you have me, use me for your kingdom. So at the end, we can all say together, we are simply unworthy servants who are simply doing what our master told us to do. We've seen this morning, we must have an enduring usefulness. And I trust you've seen there's an opportunity here to focus on having an illuminating witness, shining brightly what God has done in your life, what he's doing through you, and that we would be able to do good works so the world gives God glory. Not to us, not to us, O Lord, but to your name be glory forever. Jonathan and Sarah Edwards lived in the 18th century America, New England. They were bold and bright witnesses for Christ. Jonathan was a preacher, writer, theologian, and become later known as a preeminent American philosopher. Sarah, his wife, she was a homeschool mother of 11 children. It's amazing. She was faithful. She was hardworking, very hospitable. They deeply loved one another and stirred each other's affections for Christ, pressed one another closer to Christ, challenged one another and stimulated one another to love and good deeds. They left an incredible legacy. Their kids going on to be, many of them, faithful believers and generations of positive impact on the world. Both of them had a total devotion to Christ and a desire to make him known to others. We could look at them and honestly kind of think to ourselves, I'm kind of ashamed. Their lives are so good. They're doing so amazing things. I can't measure up. This is where Robert Murray McShane comes to our help. You can look at him and think, well, the devotional life of Robert Murray McShane, if you've read anything about him, if you know anything about him, astounding, amazing, a young man, but passionate for Christ. You could look at him and be impressed and say, I can't be like that. And yet, what does he say about Edwards? He looks at Edwards and says this, how feeble does my spark of Christianity appear beside such a sun? He says that about Edwards. But then he says, but even Edwards as a son, if you will, was a borrowed light. And the same source is still open to me. Isn't that a wonderful way that a fellow Christian, whatever effect they may have seemed to have had on history, the fellow Christians in the pews next to you can have this effect on you to say, that's amazing to see what God is doing in that person's life. And the same source is available to me. I can be impacted by Christ so that I can impact others for Christ and for his glory. Let's pray. Father God, we come before you, humbled by your word. We acknowledge that we can't do this on our own. We need your life and light coursing through our veins, God. Help us to be effective ministers for you, wherever you have placed us. So at the end of the day, you would get the glory. Help us to walk in a manner worthy of our Lord. Help us to be fully pleasing to you. Help us to bear fruit in every good work, increasing in our knowledge of you. Strengthen us, O Lord, with all power. Help us to see that you have qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Help us to see and glorify you, for you have delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of your beloved Son. We know that we have an incredible Savior, an amazing light. Help us, O God, to shine brightly that same light to the world, that more and more would come to glorify you, your everlasting praise. In your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.